every time I crossed the Alps, I found myself moved tenderly and admonishingly, as if by the breath of the warmer climate, the first sounds of a more melodious language, the first terraces of vines, and the sight of the many beautiful churches and chapels. Moved, as if by the recollection of a more gentle, milder condition of life, one closer to Mother Earth. Just as the ancient form of cultivation, of terraces with vines, mulberries, olives, endures intact, so too does something of the pious heathen, sensuously pious beliefs of classical times in the countries south of the Alps endure even today.
It was here, in Montagnola in Switzerland, that Herman Hesse died at the age of 85 on August the 9th, 1962, in the middle of summer. He lies buried in this cemetery, a cemetery embedded in the countryside which he loved so much. Herman Hesse was born in the small town of Kalv on the edge of the Black Forest in South Germany. It's a small town in the old German style, with narrow streets and timbered houses. A place where everyone knows everyone else, with churches, with fine spires. Beautiful and delicate details. It's a town which must have made a deep impression on the imagination of the young Herman Hesse. All his life, Hesse felt attached to Kalv. Today, a simple plaque is all that recalls the fact that the great German novelist and poet Herman Hesse was born in the house in the middle. The date, as the baptismal register shows, was July the 2nd, 1877. He came from a devout Christian family. His father, Johannes Hesse, was a missionary who'd spent some time in India before settling down in Kalv, where he worked for a missionary publishing company. Hesse's grandfather had also been a missionary in Asia. He published a grammar of the Malayalam language and did a great deal more to make the language better known in Europe. Herman Hesse's mother, Marie, soon had reason to worry about her son. The boy, she wrote, is full of life, has the strength of a giant, a powerful will, and quite remarkable intelligence. What will become of him? The Hesse family regarded life on earth simply as a passage to the hereafter. The young Herman Hesse was probably often reminded of the biblical parable of the false broad road and the straight and narrow path to heaven. Yet Hesse certainly enjoyed his boyhood and youth in this small German town. When he was 41, he recalled,
"When I sit once again on the side of the bridge, over which as a lad I cast my fishing line 1,000 times, then I feel deeply and with an odd sense of emotion how beautiful and remarkable this experience was for me, to once have had a home, a place where I belonged, to have been once bound to a particular point on this earth, in the same way as the tree is bound by roots and sap to one particular spot."
In 1891, at the age of 14, Hesse was sent to the Protestant seminary in Maulbronn Monastery. At first, he tried to submit to monastery discipline. He liked to sit and think by the well house in the cloisters.
In the clear shadow of the vaulted room, I saw the three basins of the fountain hovering over one another, and the singing water fell in 8 fine streams, and the vault played with the living sounds.
Soon, though, Hesse felt an overpowering urge for spiritual independence. In March 1892, Hesse ran away from the Marlborough Seminary. This marked the beginning of a serious crisis. Hesse refused to conform, but the world demanded conformity.
For over 4 years, everything people wanted to do with me went inevitably wrong. No school wanted to keep me, and no apprenticeship could I stand for long.
The young Hesse saw himself as an outsider and acted accordingly. It wasn't until 1895 that things started settling down again for him. He moved to Tübingen and started an apprenticeship in a bookshop.
It's only now that I've gradually become calm and serene again. I became mentally healthy. The bad times, full of anger and hate and thoughts of suicide, are now behind me. And at least my poetic intuition has been formed, and I've survived my storm and stress period.
Around the end of the century, Hesse took a job as an assistant bookseller in the Swiss town of Basel. This old town on the River Rhine increased his feeling for art and for history, and this was linked with a new experience of nature. But what Hesse was chiefly engaged on was the literary formulation of the serious crisis he'd now overcome. He wrote poems and short stories, and he wrote his first great novel.
I wanted you to feel ashamed of knowing more about foreign wars, about fashion, gossip, literature, and the arts, than about the spring, blossoming unrestrained outside your towns, and about the river flowing under your bridges, and about the forests and the splendid meadows through which your railways speed. I wanted you, who are perhaps happier and more cheerful than I, to discover this world with an even greater sense of pleasure.
These are words which Herman Hesse put into the mouth of the hero of his novel, Peter Camenzind. This novel was Hesse's first great success. It's the description of the life of a country lad and documents Hesse's own opposition to a modern world which is increasingly dominated by technology and the excesses of civilization.
But I also wanted to teach people to find sources of pleasure and streams of life by loving nature like a brother. I wanted to preach the art of seeing, of wandering and enjoying, of taking delight in the present. I wanted to let the mountains, the oceans and the green islands talk to you with their enticing tongues.
Peter Camenzind represented the start of an enormously successful literary career. Today, Herman Hesse is one of the world's best known and most read authors. Just like his hero, Peter Camenzind, Herman Hesse himself wanted to go
not the way of the many, but his own way, independently.
The success of Peter Camenzind meant that at long last, Hesse could stand on his own 2 feet financially as well. The novel was published in 1904, and in the same year, Hesse married Maria Bernoulli, whom he'd got to know in Basel. In line with the ideas Hesse outlined in his literary works, the young couple set out to seek isolation, close to nature. They found what they were looking for by Lake Constance on the borders of Germany and Switzerland. They bought a simple farmhouse in the small community of Geienhofen, and Hesse now started earning his living as a writer. The couple had 3 sons. In Beneath the Wheel, Hesse dealt with his own childhood experiences, telling the story of a gifted adolescent and his struggles. But despite his success, he didn't really settle down mentally. Life was good to him, but he soon realized that success alone didn't satisfy him.
It's fine to sit at a safe table, to have a safe roof over one's head and a reliable wine in the jug, to have a large, well-filled lamp burning and next door a wife playing the piano. But suddenly, like a soap bubble, the question rises in me, are you really happy?
In September 1911, Herman Hesse left Europe for Asia. He traveled around, but he couldn't find whatever it was he was looking for, at least not at first.
The palms and the birds of paradise, the rice fields and the temples of the rich coastal towns, the valleys of the tropical regions drenched in fertility. All this, and even the primeval forest, was beautiful and enchanting. But it all seemed to me to be alien and remarkable, never close to me and quite my own. Full of longing, we set out for the south and east, driven by some dark and thankful sense of a home somewhere. And what we find here is paradise, the wealth and rich lavishness of all natural gifts. But we ourselves are different. We remain alien here and without the rights of a citizen. I had to stop carrying on a feud with Europe in my heart. I had to find the true Europe and the true East and make them my own in my heart and my mind.
In 1914, when the First World War broke out, Hermann Hesse was living in Bern in Switzerland. He'd given up what he called playing the farmer in Geiernhofen. He was planning to separate from his wife and was suffering from deep depression. The ancient, beautiful and picturesque city of Bern presented him with impressions which formed a marked contrast to his own mood and emotions.
I was completely absorbed in myself and in my own fate. But occasionally, though, with the feeling that what was involved was the fate of mankind as a whole.
His only news of the war came from newspaper reports and photos, but this was enough to heighten his sense of confusion and bewilderment.
The end of the war brought with it the completion of my metamorphosis and also the climax of my sufferings. I found all of war and all the world's bloodlust, all its recklessness, all its vulgar pleasure-seeking, all its cowardice within myself. I first had to lose my respect for myself and then my contempt for myself.
He operated a book service for prisoners of war and published a newspaper for them as well. The familiar world around him seemed to be sinking in a maelstrom.
There was nothing left for me to do but to continue my gaze into chaos. A hope frequently glowed inside me, the hope of finding nature and innocence again on the other side of chaos.
It was a hope in which he was not disappointed. For those returning home from the war, Hesse had a new novel waiting, Damien. This novel is also a description of how a person finds himself. In the Swiss canton of Tessin, Hesse discovered that new world in which for him too a new beginning was possible.
It took a long time before I realized that one can't have both, that I'm a nomad and not a farmer, a searcher and not a preserver. For a long time, I castigated myself before gods and laws, which for me though were just idols. This was my mistake, my torment and my share of the guilt in the world's misery. The path of salvation doesn't lead to the left and it doesn't lead to the right. It leads inwards into one's own heart, and it's only there that God exists, and only there where there is peace.
Here in Tessin, Hermann Hesse could at long last conclude this peace with himself. He finally had the feeling of having found himself and having realized his own potential. In 1919, Hesse moved into a house called Casa Camuzzi in the town of Montagnola above Lugano. The Casa Camuzzi was and is a small fairy tale-like castle on a slope in a region which seems to have remained unchanged. The first year he spent here, he later described as the maddest, most lavish, most hard-working and most passionate period of his life. Slowly, very slowly, Hesse's inner conflicts began to resolve themselves. In these weeks and months, which were marked by new impressions, Hermann Hesse discovered brush and palette for the first time.
One day I discovered a completely new pleasure. Already 40 years of age, I suddenly started to paint. It wasn't that I thought of myself as a painter or wanted to become one. No. But painting is truly beautiful. It makes one more cheerful and more tolerant. I draw with sepia, a few mountains, sometimes too a cloud in the sky. And in the foreground, on the slope of a hill, I build up a tiny play village. Give the sky some cobalt blue, the lake a dash of Prussian blue, the village some gold ochre or Naples yellow, all very thinly. and enjoy the way the gently absorbent paper subdues the colors and makes them cohere. With moist fingers, I smear the sky to make it a little paler. And with my naive little palette, I entertain myself in capital fashion.
Around this time, Hesse wrote one of the most personal of his stories, Klingsor's Last Summer. And the hero of this story is also a painter. He's an artist who's accepted life and who finally also accepts death. Now, at last, Hesse could describe what he'd learned through his encounter with the East.
Loyalty to oneself and goodness to others.
This is a saying by Confucius. Hesse quoted it frequently and made it into a sort of maxim for his own life. He wasn't influenced just by Confucius, though, but also by a number of other sources. In his short novel, Siddhartha, Hesse attempted to come to grips with Indian philosophy. This novel was translated into a great many languages, including 12 Indian ones. Indian readers confirm Hesse's remarkable ability to get inside and really understand Buddhist teachings. But it soon became clear that Hesse hadn't forgotten his earlier, more provocative note. In 1927, he both surprised and alarmed his many readers with a novel that's the portrait of a non-conformist, and at the same time, an impassioned plea, a protest against conformity. Steppenwolf. In 1931, Hermann Hesse married the Austrian art historian Ninon Dolbin. She was an understanding and intelligent woman who was to remain by his side to the end of his life. And in the years to come, Hesse was to need her. The signs he received from his environment, the beautiful signs of nature and the changing seasons, which Hesse registered carefully every day, all these signs were in marked contrast to the signs of the times. In Germany, the Nazis had come to power, and the Nazi press attacked Hesse viciously. The news from Germany was altogether very alarming. In August 1939, the Second World War broke out. From now on, Hermann Hesse was to receive letters every day describing the new misery which afflicted the world. Letters which referred to injustice, persecution, and death. Hesse always answered those who wrote to him asking for help or advice, and he continued to do so until the end of his life. In his letters, he made clear his own critical position towards the issues of the time. These letters formed his links with the world, and enabled him to show that he shared in its misery and horror. One year after the end of the war, in 1946, Hesse published a new novel, Das Glasperlenspiel, which is known in English by two different titles, The Glass Bead Game and Magister Ludi. The Magister, the master of the title, is a man who lives in an artificial and art-loving republic which has a definite monastic character. In this novel, Hesse created a literary counterpoint to a time marked by war and political crimes. The work had a tremendous impact, and Hesse's works continue to exert an enormous worldwide influence. Siegfried Unzelt discusses the reasons for this.
Hesse's tremendous and unique influence and impact is neither the result of fashion nor manipulation. It represents a real need on the part of readers, and I think there are four main reasons for this. The first is that Hesse's language corresponds to the language of young people. The second reason is that Hesse himself was strongly influenced by the Far East, something which led him to combine the Western rational way of thinking with the Eastern meditative element in his works. The third reason is that in all his works, right from the very first to the very last, Hesse protested against repression of all kinds. And the fourth reason is that Hermann Hesse didn't stop at protest and refusal, but in each of his works, again from the very first to the very last, showed the process of becoming an individual, provided an answer to the question, how do I become myself?
The same year as the Glass Bead Game was published, the city of Frankfurt honored Hermann Hesse with the Goethe Prize. The same year, he received an even greater honor when he was awarded the Nobel Prize for Literature in Stockholm. One reason for Hesse's success is certainly his determined espousal of the cause of the individual in an age of the masses.
In the course of my development, I've not withdrawn myself from the problems of the time and have never lived in an ivory tower. But the foremost and most burning of my own problems was never the question of the state, society, but the individual human being, the unique, unstandardized personality.
A friend of Hermann Hesse's built a house for him where he could live for the rest of his life. In his final years, Hesse made intensive use of his basic human right to be an individual in the world of the mass society.
When one has grown old and done what one has to do, one is entitled quietly to make friends with death. One doesn't need people. One knows them. One has seen enough of them. What one does need is quiet.
Right to the end of his life, he never overcame his doubts, his uncertainty about how to assess his own life. In his own way, Hesse fought and lived for the freedom of the individual. We who look back on him also find it difficult to sum him up, to present a balance sheet, as it were. The end of his life is a question mark. In the final year of his life, he wrote the following lines.
What you loved and strove for, what you dreamt and lived for, do you know now whether it was sorrow or joy? Sometimes the major and the minor notes are too close together to tell apart.